Okay.
How does that play out? In other words, this woman got her money. How would that be restitution to this woman? She's a victim, she had this harm, but is there something there that's going to be compensable?
Can I jump ahead to one of my cases that I bailed myself out?
Okay.
There's a case on page 10 that actually addresses this, a Jacobs case. I had to do with annual leave, and the victim of a bodily injury, suffered bodily injury. One of the things that you can compensate for bodily injury is lost income or wages, and the court said that the value of the annual leave that she took for the injuries was income to her, and that that's worth a certain amount of money. I, too, have thought, how would that actually be, who would that be paid to? And if the bank would reconstitute her leave, and so that she basically gets that money, that time paid for, and give her another week's leave, then maybe the bank would be compensated, but otherwise she would be compensated because she had used that leave. So at least you have one case, very recent, Jacobs 1999, dealing with annual leave. And it looks like, especially if you have the statute to tie it to, and there under bodily injury, you have the lost income, lost wages terms in the statute that the court used to compensate, and they were upheld.
Okay. How about your Teller B? Which of those harms of Teller B will be compensable? That's an excellent point you make down there. Yeah, in fact, that's been one of the things that we aren't so certain that Teller B is going to get compensated for, because the statute requires that to be compensated for psychiatric care that has to have resulted from physical injury. And Teller B, in our scenario, did not suffer any physical injury. If the physical injury can somehow, or if the psychological injury can somehow be shown to be almost a manifestation of some kind of physical injury, or to manifest it itself in some kind of physical injury, perhaps that might be a possibility. Otherwise, the outcome in our case certainly doesn't look like a desired outcome, but it may be one that the statute would restrict itself to. Any feelings on that, Kathy?
I'll just mention some cases on page 10. The lawyer's always talking about cases. Here I go again. But there's three cases there in the Ninth Circuit I've got on page 10 that address specifically the physical injury requirement and how the court needs to tie it to the statutory language. And actually, the court in the Ninth Circuit, and these are not very recent cases, but they seem to still be good, awarded restitution for psychological injuries where somebody had something like bronchitis and stress and strain, and a little bit of a stretch there. But again, the court is trying to tag it to some terms in the statute. But generally speaking, I think this is a gap in the statute that Congress surely didn't intend to not give psychological treatment to tellers. And if you can find a way to maybe an expert to say that there are physical manifestations of this psychological problem, it might help. Also, some of the special restitution statutes we'll talk about in a minute help a little bit in that with child abuse and sexual abuse, for example. You have a little different wording. That's the best I can do on that one for now until we get some more cases.
Thanks. Yeah, and talking about Teller C, I think
yeah.
Teller C, you know, there really isn't much different with Teller C. Teller C had the loss wages or the expenses related to the court appearance, and that would be compensable as well. But let's look at our final victim that we have listed here, the customer. Which of those harms to the customer?
Yeah, this is an area scope of the offense. If you have bona fide victims, and it's almost as if the courts, so maybe it's an equitable consideration, but if you have a bona fide victim and you can show that it's truly caused, the harm was caused by the offense, then this step, you just need to articulate what language in the statute you're relying on, have some reasoning for it, and the courts are trying to uphold this. And I think the examples on page 10 illustrate that. There's two of them very recently, the Jacobs case and annual leave, 1999, I mentioned, but also the Crandon case in the Third Circuit, 1999, very recent case. And here we do have a restitution award for psychiatric treatment. There's a couple of things going on in this case that may or may not be applicable to other cases. For one thing, you have a child victim, and courts are going to bend over backwards to try to compensate child victims. But you also have one of our special, what we're calling special restitution statutes, where you have slightly different language, and it could be that even without this language, a court would go so far as to award restitution in this kind of a case. But in this special, the sex abuse statute for children, there's a language of all losses, and the court in Crandon analyzes and says that the psychiatric treatment was proximately caused. Now, here's a little blurring of step three and step four. As I said, that sometimes it's hard to separate the two. But they look at the treatment, and they had experts testify that this treatment would not have been caused or needed but for the offense. It was directly related to the offense, and the court didn't hesitate, didn't talk at all about the bodily injury requirement. They're going under the all losses proximately caused for sexual abuse of children. Now, they also are using the word proximately in there, and so if I had a case and I was recommending restitution under one of the regular statutes, I would point out Crandon, among others, to say that, look, here's an analysis using proximately. We don't have the all losses concept, but clearly Congress intended to expand here with restitution in 96, extent possible, and you might be able to get a psychiatric treatment award even under the regular restitution statutes. I just offer that as one of the only ones that have been analyzing this type of compensability in the last few months that might be helpful. And then finally, the Malpiso case is also cited on page 10, Second Circuit. Interesting there for a couple of reasons. One is that the court, again, made the effort to tie the restitution award to particular statutory terms, and in this case, they even combined two of them. There's a provision that says that that the defendant should be ordered to pay restitution to a third-party compensator like an insurance company, or it says any other source, that pays for the loss or the harm to the victim. And then there's the provision that we talked about where the witness, the victims can get compensation for their own fees involved in cooperating with prosecution investigation. And the court looked at these two, and in this case you had a victim who was relocated and protected by the FBI to considerable expense, and the court awarded and was upheld in awarding restitution to the FBI for the cost in relocating that victim based on analogizing to these two other provisions. So I think that Malpiso is helpful as much for the analysis as anything. It's kind of an unusual fact situation maybe, but it shows that the courts are rewarded for looking at the statutory terms and tying to those, and you can even combine them. So I think we're in a kind of a new world with restitution a little bit, and that courts might be encouraged to expand slightly, especially when you get to the compensability stage.
Okay.
How about going to step five?
Questions here actually that we think relate to step four, and maybe we can hit on a couple.
position where you would be getting civil damages for the value of that. Let's say that teller had to quit. I don't think you could compensate the bank for her value if she'd have been able to continue working. There's a limit. But up to the time of sentencing, I think if the bank could show that that was part of the cost caused by the offense, you might be able to impose that.
Laura, you had another question?
Yeah, we've got another one from Keith Hayes, Northern Georgia, we've heard from, who says he's in hot Atlanta. So if you want to weigh in on this, too, Keith, please do so. The bank, identified as a victim in a fraudulent activity, can costs associated with hiring, retaining forensic accountant by the bank be a compensable cost under 3663A for participation in prosecution of a case?
There are a few cases that deal with that, and it's sometimes easy to get the loss mixed up with the restitution cases, but trying to focus just on restitution, we do have the express provision for the cost of the victim and related to, I think is the way it reads, cooperating with participating in the investigation and prosecution. And I have seen some cases where that was extended. The Akbani case, I think, is the Eighth Circuit case, is in my handouts, actually awarded attorney's fees to a bank.
Persons other than the victim of the offense. But you can have a situation, again, like our scenario. There's that issue about whether the owner of the car that was stolen for the getaway car is going to be a victim or not. Well, even if that person may not, through the analysis, fall in as a victim, if the plea agreement includes that this person will be a victim, then that person will be compensated and treated as a victim. For not terms of the imposition of the order, imposing the restitution order, I know the statute says that they prefer that a defendant pay the full amount at once if they're able to, and if not, then that there be a payment schedule. Now, as far as the AO having a recommendation as to how these restitution orders look, can you give us some guidance there as to the position of the AO?
This, we won't be able to go into detail on this issue, unfortunately, but we recommend, and in every circuit except the Second Circuit right now, which has a peculiar situation, that the amounts be imposed as in total, full amount, due immediately. The latest judgment has the terms due immediately. And the Ahmad case and the Trigg case that are both referred to in the materials on page 19 of the handout are the best example of why that's a good way to do it. It allows the court to collect as it can, the officer to collect as he or she can, and it allows the Bureau of Prisons to collect during incarceration. If the court only sets a supervision schedule, the Bureau cannot collect during the period of incarceration. So then they would go to the court and ask for a schedule if necessary.
Okay. And again, I know we also wanted to just mention the issue about ex post facto. It seems that really while there is a split in the circuits regarding ex post facto and the Mandatory Victim Restitution Act, that we aren't really having many complications in that split in the circuits.
No, actually, I think it would just suffice it to say that in everywhere except the 7th and the 10th, you would apply the ex post facto clause in the ways that we've recommended and the Department of Justice is recommending similar application. The substantive provisions would only be applied to offenses completed on or after the act. But in the 7th and 10th circuits, and I have those cases listed in the handouts, the Bach case and the Nichols case, on page 19, I believe that is, they have held, interestingly enough, going back to what we talked about before in the concept of restoration, that the ex post facto clause does not apply to restitution penalties because restitution is not a criminal penalty, and ex post facto only applies to criminal penalties. So because it's all, the purpose is to rehabilitate and compensate and not to punish, in the 7th and 10th, they should be applying the Mandatory Victims Restitution Act fully to all offenses convicted after April of 96. And that's one reason why we're beginning to get a lot of restitution cases out of the 7th Circuit, like the Grimes case and so on. We're getting a lot out of the 7th Circuit right now because of that.
Okay. Also in your materials, we have some resources listed for you. And we want to just point out a few of those resources. We have the AO's Office of the General Counsel, that's Kathy Shop, the Probation and Pretrial Services line. It's a line that operates around the clock because you call in and leave a recorded question, and they will get back to you within a relatively short period of time, but don't use it as an emergency line because they won't get back quite that quickly. Also, at the Sentencing Commission, we have our helpline that's available to judges, law clerks, probation officers, prosecutors, and defense attorneys from 8:30 a.m. till 5 o'clock p.m. Monday through Friday Eastern Time, and we get questions there on these issues. And on our website at the Sentencing Commission, we keep a number of documents there, and a number of papers and whatnot, to include Kathy's document. And Kathy, if your document is updated, of course, we'll put that document in an updated fashion onto our website. Our time has grown to a close very quickly for us. We certainly covered the 5 steps, and I think that was the main thing that we wanted to make sure we got across to everyone this afternoon. And hit a few of the other topics that we hope to cover in our program.
restitution that we didn't get a chance to talk about much. We're not getting many questions on that. And then other penalties and costs. So there is a set procedure, and I've listed the statutes. You kind of have to put the statutes at the bottom of page 14 together like a jigsaw puzzle to come up with this order, but it is there for your use. Does that answer your question? At the time, but I sure, Chris, and I'm not sure that your position's wrong. I guess we need some cases on it. Or maybe we need to get this statute rewritten to where it makes some sense, but that's where we are right now.
Well, Kathy, maybe we can get you some cases out of the Northern District of Georgia.
Uh-huh. You'll push the issue, and then we'll know, at least for your circuit. That's great. Thank you for calling in.
Okay, now we also have some questions on setting payment schedules and also one on community restitution, actually. First, I'll get to the payment schedule question from Brian in Ohio Northern, the Toledo office. If the court orders restitution in an offense covered by mandatory statute, can the court also set a payment schedule within the freestanding order? Or does a restitution payment schedule need to be set or ordered as a condition of supervision? Kathy, I believe you were talking about this a little bit earlier. Isn't that correct?
Yeah. Payable at $100 a month beginning advice on that. I mean, it's a, if it's a big change, it probably is a good idea to do an amended judgment or just an amended order. Do we have the talker on the phone?
Actually, that was just an announcement saying that the audio portion of the conference will end in about 15 minutes.
Okay, all right, thank you.
That won't stop us.
That won't stop us. No, keep going. Everybody. So, I've lost my train of thought.
Yeah, the kind of compensation. Okay.
The statute is pretty specific on that.
Okay, thanks. Also, we have one from Jay from Minnesota. Actually, Jay faxed us in yesterday, so thanks for that. This is regarding, I believe it's, again, goes to third-party compensators. We talked about this, Kathy, a little bit. For cases off the reservation where Indian Health Services provide medical treatment for the victim's injuries, should that be used in considering IHS, a third party that is ordered restitution?
Yeah, hi, Jay. Thanks for your question. Again, I think that this would be a valid, you're getting my guess here, you know, until a court actually has these facts before it, I should qualify that. Here you have a compensator. Matter of fact, I was talking to an officer this morning that had a situation where a National Park Service ranger was killed by the victim, and the Park Service took care of the funeral. And it seems to me that the Park Service is standing in the position of a third-party provider. And in your case, Jay, you have the Indian Health Services, IHS, serving as a compensator to what the victim would have to pay. And remember, there were several cases we went through where they said if the victim had paid this themselves, we'd have to pay the victim for it, and either the funeral or in one of those cases was cooperating with the investigation, the FBI relocation costs. So therefore, we should be able to order restitution to the person or entity that provided the compensation. And read, I would recommend if you haven't read 3664 in its entirety, I sat down again recently in preparing for this and read through it again. It's amazing what's there. If you look at the pre-MVRA form, it was like one column on a page, and now it's served four pages. There's a lot there, and there's at least two references to compensating a third party or insurance company or any other source. So I think that would help.
Okay. We also have one that this might be a quick question. That's from the Southern District of Florida, Connie. Defendants pled guilty to 26 U.S.C. 7201, evading corporate income taxes, and it sounds like we could recommend restitution to the IRS as a condition of probation or supervised release. These are individuals who have an ability to pay. What do you think?
That is an issue that I didn't get around to researching, Connie, and I'm glad you're watching and you stumped me on that one. There are special.
Can I make a suggestion to you?
Yes. Thank you, Chris. I'm glad you're out there. I know that there are additional problems in tax cases, and I would just say some of the problems that Chris raised are very real, and a lot of courts are very hesitant. I wouldn't try to do that. The usual method is to just make it a condition to pay their lawful taxes, abide the law like they do any other law, because what is owed is sometimes another dispute in itself, and it's too much for you into unsupervision. But thank you, Chris. I that was my general hunch, but I hadn't done any recent research. Any other questions?
One last question from Atlanta. Are you contemplating giving this presentation to the judges?
Well, actually, we are in the process of doing that, except that it's a short version of it. We have about a 45-minute presentation that we've given in San Francisco, and 2 weeks from now in Baltimore and early September in Chicago at the National Workshops